Okay, well, I'm going to enter another league with this Legacy Hollow One deck. I'm going to record this as a video for the Channel Fireball YouTube channel, which means I want to start by telling you that this stream and video is brought to you by the new Channel Fireball Marketplace. With hundreds of local game stores on the marketplace, you can find all the sealed product and singles you need while buying from stores that support our community. Check out channelfireball.com today. And remember that you can use my affiliate code REID, R-E-I-D, if you want to support me and my content. I do appreciate that. Thanks also to Ultimate Guard, very best in supplies for storing, protecting, transporting your valuable collection. Yeah. So the deck I have in front of me is Legacy Hollow One. I like this deck because it's got the fast and explosive qualities of like a Dredge or a Hogak type of deck, but it actually doesn't rely on the graveyard very much, so it's not like you're gonna get shut down by a single Leyline of the Void or Surgical Extraction. So I do think it's a promising avenue to explore, and I'm gonna run it through a league. Putrid Imp, you wouldn't think of it just by looking at the deck list, but this is actually one of the very best cards to have in your opening hand because it works well with everything. It works well with Vengevine, works well with the Madness stuff, works well with Hollow One. Lion's Eye Diamond is also part of some of your best, most explosive hands, but it doesn't work well with Hollow One. Okay, Elves right off the bat. Wow, it looks like my opponent may have kept a hand with Once Upon a Time and Gaia's Cradle and bricked on land. We'll see. Oof, I even drew Vengevine. So you're gonna get to see right off the bat how explosive this deck can be. The only thing that would make this sweeter is if I had anger. Would I keep a hand with Once Upon a Time and Gaia's Cradle? I would. Alright, so that's my first turn. It's actually not impossible that I could lose this game against Elves, because they could just like block a little bit and then combo off on turn three. But looks like they're gonna cash it in. So this hand's awkward because Lion's Eye Diamond is good with every aspect of the deck except for Hollow One. And I don't have... If I at least had Badlands, then I could go like Teacher Damp, Rewall, Hollow One, and maybe that's good enough. But I'm going to throw this hand back. Sure, this one I can keep. Does Elves play Endurance now? I should be prepared for it, that's for sure. Alright, I think I'm going to bottom Mountain. Okay, so interesting situation already. When you cast Burning Inquiry, it is possible that you can draw and discard Angie's Ravager, and then you might want Lion's Eye Diamond on the battlefield in order to play for it, to pay for it. However, the more cards I keep in my hand, the greater the chance that I get to keep Hollow One in my hand and avoid randomly discarding it. So my usual... like play pattern when I face the situation is, if I have Angie's Ravager in my hand already, I'll play out the Lion's Eye Diamond. Or if I don't have Hollow One, I'll play out the Lion's Eye Diamond. But if I have Hollow One and no Ravager, then I'm gonna use I'm gonna make the judgment to not play the diamond, to hold it, to increase my chances. Hey, sorry about that. I was just accidentally muted. So I discarded my Hollow One, and that wound up being not a particularly good outcome or a particularly explosive turn one. So I would say I'm on track to lose this game. Not going to give up because I can just try to like do it again the next turn. But I feel like I'm likely to lose the race against Elves, given that I was on the draw and didn't have an explosive start. Grist. Yep, that answered chat's question earlier. Does the Elves player have access to Endurance? It got milled from Grist. Okay. So this time, I do not have Hollow One in my hand, so I'm going to use the Judgment Call to play out Lion's Eye Diamond. Is there anything I want to gamble for here? No, I think I should start with Burning Inquiry. Okay. So now I could gamble for Angie's Ravager and then just dump my whole hand and make a big attack. I think that's a good play. Oh, I could also get Ox of Agon. Oh no, I bored out Ox of Agonis. Okay, so in order to kill Grist, I need to send 2 3 power creatures and 1 1 power creature at Grist. All right, here we go. So there's one advantage to end of turn using Lion's Eye Diamond to Madness Out the Ravager. That would be playing around Endurance. But as long as Anger's in my graveyard, it's better for me to just do it on my main phase. So here comes Burning Inquiry. Looks like they actually do have endurance. Wow, did I discard 2 Angie's Ravagers? That's pretty sweet, although the downside is my anger is gone. And note that Angie's Ravager does have to attack each turn if able, so I'm going to have to suicide attack this one. It's not the end of the world. I do get to draw three cards off of it. Wow. Do I get to cast those? Yeah, I definitely get to cast those. Holy smokes. Swish Gaming, thanks for the raid. Welcome everybody who's coming from that channel. Could still lose. It, you know, in some sense, you can put virtually any amount of power and toughness onto the battlefield, and you can still lose if the Elves player combos off. They have one Cradle in their graveyard, though. They've gone through one Cradle and two Endurances, so, you know. We don't exactly know the contents of their library, but sometimes they can draw their whole deck and then play Greaterhoof Behemoth. Okay, probably Zenith for Heritage Druid. Griffin asks, when I use the Ultimate Guard Katana sleeves, do I use checklist cards or are they opaque enough that you don't need them? I do not use checklist cards. I believe they're opaque enough to use double face cards and have no problem. Well, this is brutal, the Elves deck comboing off. even if they hypothetically didn't kill me, I wonder if I would still, you know, I wonder what my prospects would be at that point, because there's not really anything my deck can do besides attack with a bunch of ground creatures. Hey, what's up, Ross? All right, they found another Wirewood Symbiote. They have it at this point. They're gonna get to draw their whole deck and make a bunch of mana. So the remaining question is like, do they have a second Crater Hoof Behemoth in after sideboarding? Or another Endurance, I guess, would do the trick to recycle the Crater Hoof. Good question from Legacy Council. Can we beat Allosaurus Shepherd? So hypothetically, if my opponent just puts all the creatures in their library onto the battlefield and then passes the turn with the plan of using Gaia's Cradle and Allosaurus Shepherd ability, I bet that's good enough as well. They are going to have a third Endurance, so that means that they get to recycle the Crater Hoof Behemoth. It also means I know they have at least three Endurance for game number three, when we get to that point. Okay, I think it's time to pack it in. I was feeling so good when I drew those two hollow ones. Never got to use them. So this is a tough matchup, and a matchup that's pretty much all about racing. The goal is just to have, I mean, I do get to be on the play for game three, which is important for my prospects of winning, and the goal is just to have a really explosive turn one. Jaspa in the chat is asking about Run Afoul. That's a card that people play in Legacy primarily to answer Merit Lage, like the Dark Depths deck. But it also can have applications against Murktide Regen or even Dragon's Rage Channeler. All right. Well, it's not the greatest hand ever, but it is worth keeping. I'm going to start with Bloodstained Mire for Badlands, then Once Upon a Time, then probably Burning Inquiry. Okay, I think I should take Vengevine. And I'll make a Vengevine. All right, they didn't have endurance or and or judged that they couldn't afford the two card deficit. So I have a, you know, it's gonna sound funny to say this, but this is a totally reasonable turn one. Like this is what I'm hoping for in order to keep my opening hand. It's definitely not one of the best draws that my deck can deliver, but I'm in a decent position. I think if I was on the draw this game instead of being on the play, this would likely not be good enough, but I think I'm doing reasonably well given the circumstances. Okay, so here I'm going to interesting. Okay, I'm going to play Lion's Eye Diamond. Then I'm going to cast Burning Inquiry. My opponent did not discard their Endurance. They still have it. I drew two Hollow Ones. I discarded one of them. So now I'm going to cast this. Notably, I have six cards in my graveyard, and I have Lion's Eye Diamond, so I can pump either of my creatures if my opponent chooses to block with Nettle Sentinel. The way that Elves deck works is they really need to get a little bit of traction in the early turns, so I would actually be willing to dedicate a significant number of resources to killing that Nettle Sentinel if my opponent's going to offer the trade. Like, if the Nettle Sentinel blocks either Putrid Imp or Basking Rootwalla, it's kind of going to wind up being a 2-for-1 trade against me, in the sense that I might have to either... Well, I'm either going to lose Putrid Imp plus Faithless Looting, or I'm going to lose Lion's Eye Diamond plus Faithless Looting. But either of those, I'm saying, is okay with me to get the Nettle Sentinel off the battlefield. Force of Vigor, targeting Hollow One and Lion's Eye Diamond. Holy cow. Exiling Allosaurus Shepherd. Did not expect this. So my opponent has three cards in hand, one is Endurance. Option A is just let it resolve, attack with Putrid Imp, attack with Vengevine. Option B, crack Lion's Eye Diamond for 3 green mana, pump the Rootwalla. So that would be basically like... That would basically be turning my Faithless Looting in hand into a Lightning Bolt. Which actually sounds good when I phrase it like that. Or a Lava Spike. Or option C is I could crack the Lion's Eye Diamond for red and then flashback Faithless Looting. I don't think that really does. That's not likely to do much. All right, let's make some green mana, then I can attack for 9. All right. See if it's good enough. That's what I got. That's everything I have. Can you beat it? True. There is no reason for me to not give flying to Putrid Imp there. I should have done it. Yeah, Shivam, I was excited to be on the podcast. Has it come out yet? And for those asking, you can find the deck list by clicking on Stream Deck or Current Deck List. That would have been good when I still had cards in hand. Alright, podcast out today. So that's the Casual Magic Podcast, and let's see. I'll put a link in the chat for those of you who are here joining me live. Meanwhile, Ramsal, thank you for the sub. All right, we're scrapping it out. Sideboard games can be like this sometimes. It's like, okay, somebody mulligans, then there's a force of vigor involved, and we're just trying to scrape over the finish line. I mean, I got a plan. I could just wait four turns and firestorm for four. That is a plan. Why didn't I attack with Root Wallach? Well, my opponent did have an untapped 2-2. So, big decision here. Do I play this so that I can represent a pump on the Root Wallach, or do I just hold it for Firestorm? I'm on the Firestorm plan. I'm just trying to amass enough resources to cast that card. Alright, I believe I'm one draw step away from winning. Miso, thank you so much for your continued support. So, we still have a dead on board situation, right? Like, yep. So didn't even need the Firestorm in the end. That was a good match, including a really tight game three. Funny, I've actually beaten Elves three times so far in my experience with this deck, but every time it feels like I'm like getting pretty lucky and just barely getting over the finish line. It feels like it should be a very close or unfavorable matchup. Wow, Gaussian Integers, that's 10 gift subs today in the chat. I'm so grateful. Like I said, above and beyond the Call of Duty, but thank you so much and thank you for being here. Okay, here we are, match number two with Legacy Hollowvine. Alright, sometimes it takes me a minute to parse my opening hand. This hand has no discard outlet. So unless I can Once Upon a Time into a Putrid Imp, then I can't really get the ball rolling. And I have a policy that I'm not going to keep a 7-card hand hoping to hit Putrid Imp off of Once Upon a Time. I think that's not good enough. I'm going to mulligan looking for, you know, hopefully Putrid Imp, Lion's Eye Diamond, Burning Inquiry, something along those lines. Yeah, Merry Christmas indeed. Happy Holidays. All right, this hand has a little bit more potential, I'd say. All right, it's a repeat of the same matchup. This time I'm on the draw against an opponent who kept 7 cards, so prospects are a little bit dicier. Okay, so I'm going to go Putrid Imp, Vengevine, Rootwalla. Then the question is, do I want Angie's Ravager to play it on turn 2 and attack on turn 3? I don't even know if I'm going to get a turn 3. Or do I want Blazing Rootwalla just to have another attacker? I guess Angie's Ravager is just enough better. These Legacy Leagues feel streaky. It's funny because there's like, you know, 20 or 30 or 50 different decks in Legacy. But last week it was like I just kept facing Reanimator over and over again. Today it seems Elves over and over and over again. Great question from Skeptimist in the chat. Do I think this deck is better than Hogak? I think it is probably a little bit worse than Hogak as a game one deck, but the reason that I like it is if you're playing Hogak and your opponent starts the game with Leyline of the Void, you have to remove that Leyline of the Void or else you can't win. This deck, it's easy to win through Graveyard Hate. Graveyard Hate is like arguably just not even that good against you. So in that sense, I find this deck more difficult to hate out, a little bit more like resilient. All right, I think there's virtually no way I'm winning this game. Like the trifecta of Symbio, Visionary, and Gaia's Cradle is just going to be a bit much. Excuse me, I had to do mandatory kitten handoff there. My girlfriend's on a video call in the other room, so she had to have a turn showing off the kitten to her camera. Jim Jam writes, this deck doesn't feel explosive enough to run zero interaction. Yeah, I think that's a reasonable stance. I think you would not choose this deck if you expected to face a lot of combo decks that are faster than it. It's more going to be going to excel in a field of like Delver and control decks. It's also, a lot of times in Legacy, you can sort of pick a couple of combo decks that you're going to sideboard enough to beat. So like for my build, I have a bunch of Graveyard Hate in my sideboard, but combo decks that don't use the graveyard are certainly a bit tricky. Okay, so I suppose I want to start with Faithless Looting here. Not great. How's the matchup against Show and Tell? Well, just as I was saying a moment ago, I don't think you would choose Hollow Vine if you expected to face a lot of combo decks. I mean, you could naturally win if you just get to go first and have a really fast draw, but I don't think that's the matchup you're hoping to get. Okay, this is interesting here. I guess I can make a Vengevine. And they play Whack-A-Mole. And So that's a main deck endurance, which is fine, I guess. All of this, mind you, is mostly futile. Like, I'm expecting the Elves player to win the game this turn, but as long as I'm still playing, I have to continue maximizing everything and trying to put on as much pressure as I can. Leningrad, thanks for the sub. So the best card against Elves. I mean, I guess I'm trying out Firestorm as an option. I haven't loved Firestorm in part because after turn one or two, a lot of times I just don't have cards in my hand anymore. So it's like, okay, it's great if I can set it up exactly on turn two for a big blowout play, but if I draw it later, it doesn't really help me get back into the game. It's possible that just end the festivities or something along those lines would be better. You know, maybe Plague Engineer, although that's a little bit difficult to get three mana reliably. Dirk, thank you also for the sub. Oh, Fury. Yeah, Fury's a good idea. That could be better than end the festivities. Well, I got Firestorm in my opening hand. This hand looks like it's probably going to involve gambling for Lion's Eye Diamond. So, like, gamble for Lion's Eye Diamond. If I discard the Lion's Eye Diamond, which is 1/6, that's it. I probably lose this game, but that might be an acceptable risk. If I keep the Lion's Eye Diamond, then on turn two, I can like do some combination of double Ravager and or Firestorm. I could also just turn one attack with Ravager. I mean, I'm going to keep it. I'm going to keep it and gamble for LED. Ging, thanks for the sub. Or, yeah. Oh, GG. We hit the 1-6 where I discarded the card that I gambled for. So that was definitely a calculated risk. And that's why the card's called Gamble. Okay. Let's see if this firestorm gets me out of this. Okay.
What are they?
All right, land maybe? Lion's Eye Diamond? Faithless looting. Man, it's just been so awkward not being able to get these Ravagers onto the battlefield. I'm going to attack and then potentially take 15 damage on the crackback. But I'm not going to win the game by chump blocking. They didn't have enough mana to activate on defense. It costs 6. Okay. Well, that was a more convincing result against elves. Granted, I did get a little bit unlucky with the gamble. So the turn that I attacked into the Allosaurus Shepherd, they didn't have Heritage Druid yet. So as far as I can tell, they could only generate 4 mana. Okay. Ooh. NZD. Welcome back, match number 3 with Legacy Hollowvine. I'm on the draw with a Simian Spirit Guide, a Burning Inquiry, and a big heart. But no, I think I'm gonna throw this one back. That's, I guess, better. Quick and painless, at least. Alright, so if my opponent keeps 7, then I probably just have to mulligan to Leyline. And they did keep 7. This hand is like, I mean, I can play some creatures on turn 1. Hypothetically, a Fairy Macabre's in my top 2 cards. I guess I'll mulligan. Burning Inquiry and just try to mess up their hand. I'll just keep mulliganing and try to hit Leyline. There we go. So 4 cards. I'll be keeping Leyline, Bloodstained Mire, Burning Inquiry, and probably what? Blazing Rootwalla? Sure. I think I'm just attacking for three again. Yep. Okay. Balustrade Spy targeting me. So I guess I would like to fetch in response to that. Actually kind of like Faithless Looting from Graveyard. Why did they target us? Why did they target me? Because if they targeted themselves, they would have milled out their whole library, and against Leyline, they would just lose. Yeah, I'm going to flashback Faithless Looting. Cabal Therapy. Burning Inquiry. Alright, I guess I'm just happy paying full retail price for Angie's Ravager. I don't have an anger in my graveyard. So that's my turn. Alright, the Mulligan to 4. Leyline was good enough. This time I get to keep 7 with a ley line. Pleased about that. Okay, so this is going to be fetch for Badlands, cast Once Upon a Time. All right, so I can go Putrid Imp, discard Vengevine, cast Rue Walla, get back Vengevine. Then I can also add additional power by playing a Rue Walla, by discarding another card and playing a hollow one. So I guess we can rule out the Ruwala option. Or I can take Fairy Macabre in case my opponent blows up the ley line and then tries to combo off. So basically it's like, would I rather put, you know, 10 plus power on the battlefield and clock my opponent for 2 turns? Or would I rather put more like, you know, 6 to 8 power on the battlefield and have a second layer of defense? I think I'm going to take the Fairy Macabre. You just got to think about the worst case scenario, and I think worst case scenario involves Force of Vigor destroying Leyline right now. The actual worst case scenario might involve a transformed sideboard, like, you know, my opponent boards into Charbelcher or something like that, but that didn't seem to be the case in game number 2. But if my opponent kills me with Charbelcher on exactly turn 3, then, you know, I guess the clock doesn't even change that much with the hollow one anyway. Though I will say that just dealing a lot of damage is pretty effective against a deck that has to lightning bolt themselves every time they play a land untapped. we'll see. This is it. Okay, I won. Well, I can't say it was fascinating gameplay, but at least, you know, kind of cool to see how two unusual decks match up against one another. Sure. This hand is super all in, but that's what you sign up for. Uh-oh. Well, that's not technically game because I can bait with the Once Upon a Time, but that is not a good sign. Oops. Yeah, I mean, now my hand's like not really functional anymore. Okay, well, now I am going to play the Tarn, pass, end of turn Once Upon a Time, and pay the tax. Hopefully find Putrid Imp. Come on, Putrid Imp. Lion's Eye Diamond. Yes, Putrid Imp. Hmm. Elesh Norn. Right. I don't think they have it. I think they're about to flashback Faithless Looting. Which means, can I win? If I play two more Ruwallas, I pump one, that's 7, 8, 9, 10. Not quite. I can get them low enough that Reanimate is not an out. Exiles Reanimate with Grief's ability, casts Grief for its evoke cost. That's fine. Wow, I won game one against Reanimator. Bring in the seven black cards. Another seven card hand with Leyline. It's not the most explosive hand, but I'm definitely going to keep a functional hand with Leyline. Okay. Fair enough. Yep. Well, I did bring in two bone shards, so I could hypothetically win the game by finding one of those. Discarded a Vengevine. Okay. So I think I just discard two lands and then try to rebuild next turn. All right, that's good enough for me. Taking away the bone shards, I can't win after that. Sketchy hand with no ley line. I'm gonna mulligan. And much better hand with a ley line. I'm gonna keep. So let's bottom the taiga. Well. Actually, let's bottom the Bloodstained Mire. Start with the ley line. Cast Burning Inquiry. That is an amazing start. Though I can still lose to Serenity because it kills my Hollow One as well. But I made my opponent discard their scrub land, so if they have to have the two card combo of Serenity plus Lotus Petal, I believe. How aggressively do I mulligan for ley line in these matches, in these matchups? Pretty aggressively. If you were here last match, I won on a mull to four because I found ley line against the Oops All Spells deck. Oh, they have multiple scrub lands. That's surprising. Destroy the ley line. Man, am I gonna lose after that start? No, not necessarily. They might be on end of turn in tomb and then hope to find a second source of mana or something. Here we go, moment of truth. Could it be Dark Ritual Exhume? Dark Ritual Animate Dead? Ooh! I escaped with my life. Alright. That puts me at 3-1. Looking for one more match here. Do I keep notes on my match results? I do. I just wrote 2-1 versus Reanimator. That's the only note I took. And I don't even always look back at the notes, but at least if I have a question, like if I wanted to go, oh, you know, what's my overall record against elves? If that for some reason became an interesting question to me, at least I'd have the results written down somewhere. Come on, bud. The people demand kittens. His favorite spot is just under the camera. Welcome back to the fifth and final match with Legacy Hollowvine. This is not the most explosive hand ever, but I do usually keep a reasonable hand with turn one Burning Inquiry. Classic Dredge? Well, that makes me less excited about this Burning Inquiry, I'll tell you that much. I think I'm probably just not winning game one, realistically. It is true that this league was 5 out of 5 combo decks. If you count elves as combo, it's literally 5 out of 5 combo. Where's all the Narco Amiibos? Okay, so they got my Angie's Ravager. All right, I think I've seen enough. So, Burning Inquiry is going to be really bad in the games that I do not have Leyline, but it is good if I have Leyline, so I don't know. Maybe 3 is fine. Seven card hand with Leyline. I'm thrilled to keep this. Just gonna Hollywood a little bit to make it maybe not so obvious that I have Leyline when I keep my hand. Five, four, three, two, one. Okay, I guess I'll keep. Okay, I will select Fairy Macabre. And I'll play the Burning Inquiry. I hit two Nature's Claims. That's what I was saying. The combo of Leyline of the Void plus Burning Inquiry plus Extreme Luck. That's exactly what we needed. That said, I don't really have much going on besides this Ruwalla. See if we can get 7 attacks with the Ruwalla. Maybe only 6, because they got a lot of pain lands. making this trade? Probably, right? I don't think there's any reason not to. Alright, we're on the discard to hand size plan. Careful study, that's good. Madness the hard way. Actually, that was probably just not even a good play. I'm sure I should have just done Putrid Imp into Vengevine, Vengevine, Ruwala. I mean, either way, I can effectively clock for next turn, so it's fine. But I mean, now I might have to discard the Fairy Macabre. It's just much worse. It's just a much worse play. So yeah, pretty sure this is over because my opponent's not going to be able to tap any lands after they take 11. All right, I guess this is it. I think I basically have to mulligan to ley line. What's run afoul for? Primarily decks that generate Merit Lage. So my opponent mulled to 6, kept the 6. My hand can attack for 10 damage on the first turn. Is that good enough? Or should I continue mulliganing, trying to find ley line? One thing that can happen in a post-board game is that my opponent could have kept their hand on the strength of having a ley line answer. So, for example, if they already mulled to 6, they see, like, oh, I have a land, a nature's claim, and, like, you know, maybe some other stuff. They're probably keeping that. So there is some chance that I could just win with a really fast draw. All right, I'll try it. And I'm going to be bottoming. I guess the second land doesn't do much, right? And then, you know, especially with all the pain lands in the dredge deck, I can put the squeeze on them pretty quick. Ooh, Fairy Macabre. That's actually interesting, Fairy Macabre. Because if they go for the Lion's Eye Diamond, I could get them. But still, I think I just stick with the plan. Do it, right? I think I gotta do it. There is definitely some scenario, especially if my opponent is reckless and or doesn't expect the Fairy Macabre, where it would work out really well to just play slow and try to use this and ruin them. But my opponent's really sharp, and they saw the Fairy Macabre last game, and I think I should just not overthink this. YOLO, as Aspiring Spike says in the chat, can't argue with that. That was the fateful choice. That was the choice of the league right there. Is do I go for the big turn one, or do I sit on the Fairy Macabre? All right, suffer 10 damage. Okay, so I think that's exactly what happened, is I think they kept a hand on the strength of an answer to Leyline. That's my read on the situation. So yeah, Nature's Claim, Golgari Grave Troll. Ooh, but Ox of Agonis. This could still be enough. Ox of Agonis is extremely scary. Okay, so what do we see? Cabal Therapy, Bridge, not much else. All right. That was 4-1 with Legacy Hollowvine. It was a fun league. I think I ran pretty bad in the sense that I got like effectively 5 bad pairings, 5 combo decks, when you certainly don't choose this deck if you're facing faster combo decks. But I probably ran, you know, a little bit hot in terms of good draws, good Burning Inquiries, and you know, dodging bullets when I needed to, and 4-1 is a result I'm happy with.